Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa. I woke up real angry today after I read a very serious article on Al Jazeera website. The article was about a fatwa from the High Council of Scholars in Saudi Arabia, which tweeted a very disturbing ruling about the Muslim Brotherhood or Al-Ikhwan Al-Muslimin. Their fatwa is also attached with this talk here on the main poster. The purpose of this fatwa is to vilify the Muslim Brotherhood and justify the embargo and sanctions imposed on a Muslim country, Qatar. Usually, I do not dive into political battles because to me, all politicians are corrupted in one way or another, or at one level or the other. But when I saw Islam being used to justify evil, then the necessity and obligation to speak up becomes paramount. There are many people today that are employed by the Saudi government, and many of them either are here working in the United Kingdom or in Europe, or were taken into Saudi Arabia and massively produced, as they call them, the mass-produced sheikhs, where they are taken there to university for 3-4 years and brainwashed into something called the Salafi madhab, or the Salafi reasoning or thinking, whatever you call it, which is obviously not true. It's just Wahabism disguised as a Salafi. Yet many of these preachers are employed people, and you put 1,000 lines under employed, that are also financed by the Saudi government by an independent body called the Dawah Office. Wherever there is a Saudi embassy, there is this Dawah Office. So anyone who dares to step out or speak up against what's happening in Saudi Arabia or wherever Saudi Arabia is involved will find himself or herself without a job. This is why they do not speak, and they keep you preoccupied with this eating hadith, make this dhikr, make this tasbih, as if Islam is only dhikr and tasbih, and that's that, not a way of life, as Allah says in the Quran, لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينَ. You have a set of rules that governs your life, and I have a set of rules that governs my own life. The second technique used by the Wahhabi movement is the intense brainwashing that students go through when they are studying under the Saudi extremist Islamic education system that evolves totally around the total submission and absolute servitude to the ruling party, which happens to be the Saudi monarch. I deliberately use the term servitude because it is defined in the dictionary as being a slave or completely subject to someone more powerful. And such is the state of those who claim to be the main leaders of the Islamic world. So why am I angry with them? Because of their manipulation of the Islamic laws and teachings to suit their masters. And before going any further, let me mention what they issued, then you will know, just like I know, why I am so angry and upset. And then after that, I will take you on a journey to shed some light on the Muslim Brotherhood, then expose those people, I mean the Saudi, and why for the last 89 years the Muslim Brotherhood weren't vilified as they sadly are these days. For 89 years or maybe 90 years, the Muslim Brotherhood, nobody spoke against them, and why suddenly everybody now is calling them an international terrorist organization. Here is the transgressing fatwa of the bunch in Saudi Arabia. They had the title as هذه حقيقة الإخوان المسلمين. This is the truth about the Muslim Brotherhood. Number one, ليس لهم عناية بالعقيدة ولا بالسنة. They do not have any interest nor care about the عقيدة nor with the Sunnah. Number two, ليس من أهل المناهج الصحيحة. They are not of the people with the authentic curriculums. Number three, لا يهتمون بالدعوة إلى تصحيح العقيدة. They pay no attention to calling to the correction of العقيدة. Number four, عقيدة is the belief or the creed. Number four, حزبيون يريدون التوصل إلى الحكم. They are political party seeking to reach rulings. Number five, منهجهم قائم على الخروج على الدولة. Their curriculum or their system relies on going against and opposing the government. And the last two ones that is against the government is what they are after. And before going any further, I'd like to say something. I am not a member of the Muslim Brotherhood, nor have I ever been. I have never supported the Muslim Brotherhood as a political party because they are a party and I am not a party person at all. However, I helped them as my brother would help another brother because Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةً. Certainly or verily, what everyone put in there, the believers are but brothers. Number three, I have had my share of differences with them on some topics, just like I have had my share of differences with the claimed and pretentious people that call themselves Salafi. And throughout my Islamic education and Islamic jobs that I occupied, I have been close to the Wahhabi movement, so I know exactly how they think, what they say behind doors, what they say in front of your face. They blame the Shia for having the taqiyya. The taqiyya is the protective or a shield that they put between you and them. But yet, they are very good at using it themselves. In this pep talk, I will be speaking about the Muslim Brotherhood. But since Muslim Brotherhood is linked to the past, I will need to take you on a journey a little bit forward to the day where the first state of Saudi Arabia was formed. And I will tell you about its inception, the reasons behind the Muslim Brotherhood inception, the people behind its inception, and the purpose of its inception. The story of the Muslim Brotherhood is not that of one man, Hassan al-Banna, the founder, who just one day decided to found an Islamic organization and name it the Muslim Brotherhood or Al-Ikhwan al-Muslimin. The foundation has got more to it than meets the eyes. And by uncovering the real purpose behind this foundation, so many things will come and become clear to you in the open today. We all know that every newborn baby has a father and a mother. So if Egypt was the mother who gave birth to the Muslim Brotherhood, who was the father? Who was the father that wooed the mother into making the baby? Who named the baby the Muslim Brotherhood? Since the baby takes from the genomes of his parents, what were the Muslim Brotherhood genes? When did the father and mother divorce, and who took care of the Muslim Brotherhood baby? Did the Muslim Brotherhood kid have any siblings? Who educated the Muslim Brotherhood child? Was it the father or the mother or both? These and many questions will be answered in this pep talk. So sit tight and enjoy the ride that will further open your eyes on what truly is going on behind the scenes today and why things are happening the way they do. And let me start here by saying there is a great link, and it is impossible to talk about the Ikhwan al-Muslimin or the Muslim Brotherhood without mentioning the father Saudi Arabia. Yes, Saudi Arabia is the father of the Muslim Brotherhood's child. It is Saudi Arabia that further fathered the Muslim Brotherhood, financed it, and used it to serve its own Saudi Wahhabi agenda at first. And here is how it all started. The Muslim Brotherhood, even though it was born in Egypt, but its father, as I said, the Saudi Wahhabism agenda or alliance, had already fathered another child in Saudi Arabia. And these two siblings have a great connection. The Muslim Brotherhood is the second child in the huge family fathered by Saudi Arabia throughout the world since its first inception until our time now. Let me take you a bit back in the time of the revolution led by Mohamed Ibn AbdulWahaab, and that when it all started. As I already mentioned, it is impossible to speak about the Muslim Brotherhood without digging out further dirt from history. There was a time when Egypt, back then a very civilized country under the leadership of a Turkish governor called Muhammad Ali Pasha, who really made of Egypt what earned it the title of Ummud-Dunya, the capital of the world. Muhammad Ali ruled from 1805 till 1848, over 220 years ago. That's how far deep in history we're going to go back. It is in that era that the king of the Ottoman Empire, who suffered by the hands of Mohammed ibn Abdul Wahab had rebelled at that time against the ruling kingdom at that moment there. Saudi Arabia was, or the whole Middle East, was under the leadership of the Ottoman Khilafah. But the Khilafah was very far from Saudi Arabia, so that part of the world was a little bit abandoned. Nevertheless, it belonged to the Turkish Empire. Today, the scholars in Saudi Arabia try, because you see, they can't say you cannot fight the ruler and their own history started by fighting a ruler. So they cannot say not to do something that they themselves did, and for that they lied and they said that the Gulf or the Middle East did not belong to anybody. And such is a huge lie, because if any armies had attacked the Middle East, the Turkish armies would have come to defend it. So the Middle East belonged to the Ottoman, to the Khilafah, to the Turkish government back then. And Mohammed ibn Abdul Wahhab went out on a ruling leader, a legitimate ruling leader. Due to the long distance between Ad-Dar'iyah, which exists today in the county of Najd in Saudi Arabia. Ad-Dar'iyah is about 20 kilometers east of the capital of Saudi Arabia today, Riyadh. Ad-Dar'iyah was the very first department state of the Saudi state, the very first Saudi state. And it is from it that the inhumane and bloody events took place for over 50 years under the oppression swords of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and his gangs from one end and the King Muhammad Saud from the other. But how did the journey to extremism happen to Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab? Well, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was born in the year of 1703, and he died in the year or on the year of the 22nd of June, 1792. And this is as documented in Tariq ibn Ghannam. This is the personal historian writer of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. His journey into the studies of Islam began first under the supervision and teachings of Muhammad Haya al-Sindi in Al-Madina. It is interesting to mention that Muhammad Haya al-Sindi was following a Sufism branch or order of the Naqshbandi, and he was well known for it in Al-Madina. It is perhaps because of this reason that his first teacher was of the Naqshbandi order that Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab turned against this order later on and retaliated against people who worshipped allegedly graves and things like that, which is hard to believe as the other scholars have mentioned in their own books. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and As-Sindi became very close, and Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab stayed for some time to study with this great sheikh. As-Sindi has had a huge influence on Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and taught him how to utilize ijtihad, which is the informed individual analysis. It's a stage when you study Islam where you reach and you can use the different texts to come up with an understanding out of your own self. Strangely enough, Muhammad Haya al-Sindi also taught Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab the rejection of the Sufism religious practices associated with the walis and people's respect of the graves and things like that, because As-Sindi was not a worshipper of the grave and things like that. And it looks like that Muhammad Haya al-Sindi had influenced the belief and understanding of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. It is extremely important to mention that this teaching was the foundation to the Wahabism later on under the leadership of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, and which also led to the bloody events under his leadership and why he carried what he did and for what purpose and what reason did he kill that great number of Muslims just because he deemed them polytheists or mushriks or not Muslims, as he wrote in his books of history, Ad-Durar al-Saniyah and Tariq ibn Ghannam. In his journey to seeking knowledge, he kept traveling between Mecca, Medina, and some parts of Al-Iraq. When also he came back home, he was taught by his father, who was also a scholar, and by his brother named Sulaiman, Sulaiman ibn AbdulWahaab. Both men realized, i.e. the father and the brother of Muhammad ibn AbdulWahaab, they both realized that the brother or the son, Muhammad ibn AbdulWahaab, had some extremist tendencies. And from that, they rejected all these tendencies. Muhammad ibn AbdulWahaab had one problem facing him, and that was his father. He could not preach what he has learned in his journey. And he waited until his dad died, and that is when he openly preached his extremist in his brother Sulaiman as his mortal and eternal enemy. Even in the books written by Sheikh Sulaiman ibn AbdulWahaab, you will find references to him responding against his brother's allegations and the halalism, or making halal the killing of Muslims in his time. A lot of those who claim to be Salafis today will tell you, no, when he came, the Muslims there were worshipping graves and they were not Muslims and blah, blah, blah. But that is absolutely rubbish, nonsense. Anyone who dares to read can take the books of Ad-Durar As-Saniyah and you read the first 100 pages in Arabic, or you read Tariq ibn Khannam. However, do not read the recent versions, because they have been changed and played with by scholars in Saudi Arabia to change the reality and history. Read the old versions. They are on the internet, and you are going to be extremely surprised at what you are going to read there. These events were documented by the personal historian of Muhammad ibn AbdulWahaab. That's why it's called Tariq ibn Ghannam. Anyway, after the death of his father, Muhammad ibn AbdulWahaab exploded and turned the area upside down, and making of his brother, as I said, Sulaiman, a mortal enemy along the way. Muhammad ibn AbdulWahaab rejected a lot of things because of his informed analysis, or his thoughts that he could perform ijtihad, become independent in issuing Islamic rulings and things like that. He regarded so many normal things at that time there as evil, an innovation in matters of religion or an act of polytheism, and that is the shirk. Then he started with and by the sword, calling people to his understanding version of Islam, and considered anyone who wouldn't take his version as polytheists, mushrik, and then he would issue fatwas as to why the people should be killed and for what reason. That was really horrendous what was happening at that time there. Things got out of hand when he issued fatwa as to the permissibility of killing people, and these people are Muslims, men, Muslims, women, and kids. So many scholars, including his brother Sulaiman, had written books to help him see better and avoid extremism and shedding the blood of Muslims. And many scholars had their head decapitated in the name of promoting the true version of Islam. But the most chilling, horrifying, shocking, and unbelievable statement a human has ever made is that of Muhammad ibn AbdulWahaab himself, in one of his letters that he wrote, and you can find this in Ad-Durar As-Saniyah, in his personal letters, letter number 28. And this is printed by the University of Muhammad ibn Saud al-Islamiyah, or the Islamic University of Muhammad ibn Saud. I'm going to read to you a text in Arabic, then translate into English, and you're not going to believe what this man here said to push his agenda. وَأَنَا أُخْبِرُكُمْ عَنْ نَفْسِي. And I tell you about myself. وَاللَّهِ الَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ لَقَدْ طَلَبْتُ الْعِلْمِ. By Allah, the one, there is no God but Him, I have sought knowledge. وَأَعْتَقِدُ مَنْ عَرَفَنِي أَنَّ لِي مَعْرِفَةً وَأَنَا ذَلِكَ الْوَقْتِ لَا أَعْرِفُ مَعْنَى لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. And I believe that any who knew me thought I had knowledge, and I, at that time, didn't know the meaning of La ilaha illallah. وَلَا أَعْرِفُ دِينَ الْإِسْلَامِ قَبْلَ هَذَا الْخَيْرِ الَّذِي مَنَّ اللَّهُ بِهِ. I also didn't know the religion of Islam before this goodness, i.e. his understanding, that Allah has gifted me with. وَكَذَلِكَ مَشَايِخِي مَا مِنْهُمْ رَجُلٌ عَرَفَ ذَلِكَ. The same is also for my teachers, i.e. his scholars. None of them knew that. فَمَنْ زَعْمَ مِنْ عُلَمَاءِ الْعَارِضِ أَنَّهُ عَرَفَ مَعْنَى لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. So whoever pretends of the scholars of the area of Najd that he knew the meaning of لا إله إلا الله أو عرف معنى الإسلام قبل هذا الوقت, or that he knew the meaning of Islam before this time, أو زعم عن مشايخه أن أحدا عرف ذلك, or claimed that his scholars or any of them knew that too, i.e. the meaning of Islam, فقد كذب وافترى, then he has lied and conjured up a lie. وَلَبَّسَ عَلَى النَّاسِ وَمَدَحَ نَفْسَهُ بِمَا لَيْسَ فِيهَا, and he has masked the truth on people and has praised himself with what he deserves not. And as I said, this is an Ad-Durar As-Saniyah. Let me read this back to you in English in one go. Imagine you received a letter from somebody who claims to be a great scholar of Islam telling you this. Let's see how you feel. And I tell you about myself. By Allah, the one there is no God but Him, I have sought knowledge, and I believe that any who knew me thought I had knowledge. And I, at that time, didn't know the meaning of La ilaha illallah. I also didn't know the religion of Islam before this goodness that Allah has gifted me with. The same is also for my teachers. None of them knew that. So whoever pretends of the scholars of the area of Najd that he knew the meaning of La ilaha illallah, or that he knew the meaning of Al-Islam before this time, or claimed that his scholars, any of them knew that too, i.e. the meaning of Islam, then he has lied and conjured up lies and has masked the truth on people and has praised himself with what he does not have or doesn't belong to him. So what he is telling us is that all the studies that he got from his father, who is a scholar in the Hanbali school of thought, his brother Sulaiman, who is a great scholar, even people today testify he was a great scholar, by Muhammad Haya As-Sindi, who also a great scholar, by all the bunch of great scholars who were there in his time, and the list goes on. There was even Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, not long far from him. So he's saying that none of the people knew the true meaning of La ilaha illallah, and none of them knew the true meaning of Islam. This is him issuing a general takfir, general statement of disbelief on every Muslim in his time. You know what it means to, you go to someone who is a scholar, who teaches people and he's doing salat, that he doesn't know the meaning of La ilaha illallah, and he doesn't know the meaning of Al-Islam? What's wrong with this guy? How big is his head? How big is his head? And today they tell us the great Imam Mohamed Ibn AbdulWahaab ain't no great Imam. This man has got some serious issues. And if you could read his books in Arabic and what has been written, you will understand. And inshallah, I will reveal some more about this identity. Amazingly so, this dark, unjust, and horrifying statement is at the core of the claim to be Salafi. The meaning of the statement is always the same. Though they might change the wordings from here to there, but the meaning is the same. This is why the Wahhabis and the pretentious Salafis think that they are the only ones who know the true meaning of Islam, and every other of us is destined to hellfire for eternity. I don't wish to spend too much time on this man and all this kind of sick thinking or sick belief, but needless to say that he rebelled with the help of Muhammad ibn Saud, and was the governor of Ad-Dar'iyah, against the legitimate Khilafa of Mustafa al-Rabi. The king's name was Mustafa IV. Him and the army of murderers and Muhammad ibn Saud were defeated by Muhammad Ali Basha. And with that, the first Saudi state was destroyed in 1818. Muhammad ibn AbdulWahaab died at the age of 90-ish in the year 1792. With his death, the sword on Muslims came down. His continuous calls to violence and murdering altered, and Muslims celebrated and were very happy to get back to rulership of the Ottomans, Khilafah. And Muslims in the Middle East enjoyed a long 119 years of peace. By now, you might wonder as to why I am talking about Mohamed Ibn AbdulWahaab when the talk is about the Muslim Brotherhood. Well, they are linked, because Mohamed Ibn AbdulWahaab had killed, and you will see in my, just in my next section, what the teachings of Mohamed Ibn AbdulWahaab produced in his time, 120 years after his death, and what the teachings of Mohamed Ibn AbdulWahaab are still producing today, almost another 100 years or 200 years after his death. It's really scary that our Islam is linked to a dark, sad, and horrific, almost vampire-like past. Very, very bloody, thirsty for blood. That is a part of our history that is so dark that today they are trying their very best. They're trying their very best to create a new story, a new history. But alhamdulillah, the books are out and we know what Mohamed Ibn AbdulWahaab has done and how his teachings are still causing blood to run free in the free world today. As I already mentioned, after the death of Mohamed Ibn AbdulWahaab, the Muslims started breathing again and not fear the sound of the Wahhabi swords for 119 years non-stop, until a group of Bedouins started migration from the open desert to the northern parts of Riyadh to a place called Al-Artawiya. The first migration took place in 1911. The people that migrated used to call it Hijra, migration, and what they meant by that was that some people, Bedouins, had had enough of living in the desert and a place of sin. So they wanted all to migrate to a common place where they can worship Allah as He ought to be. So what they did is they started their migration. The migration was then for a worship purposes. When the Saudi scholars of today, when they wanted to rewrite history and they fabricated a new meaning, they said the Bedouins had had enough of the desert and they wanted to live in civilization. And this is an awful, absolute lie. The people migrated because they wanted a place so that they can worship Allah all together. Even the people today that claim to be Salafis, when we want to live in Egypt, I recall vividly saying them, they want to make Hijra. The concept of this Saudi late event is still living with us today. But again, as I said, the Wahhabis of today are faking the meaning to migration for a better life. But history belies this evil and false pretense, and so does the name these newly arrived settlers would give to themselves. When people heard of this migration, that there was a group at the northern parts, Al-Artawiya, were worshipping Allah according to the Salaf, people started migrating to them from all around the Gulf. And that's how about 200 migrations were made to Al-Artawiya. And before long, those settlers became the main army of King AbdulAziz ibn AbdulRahman al-Saud. They were the main force of him. Do you know what the settlers, what name they gave to themselves? In Arabic, it's called Ikhwan Man Ata'a Allah or Ikhwan Man Ta'a Allah. In English, it's called the Brotherhood of Those Who Obeyed Allah. And you can see how dangerous that is, because in their own thinking, they are the only ones that are actually obeying Allah, and the rest of the Muslim world is not obeying Allah, because they have an understanding that Allah should be worshipped this way. Anyone who follows this way is obeying Allah. And do you know which way they were following? That of Muhammad ibn AbdulWahaab, what they call today the Salafi, what the Salafi is all about. So the Salafi and the Brotherhood of Those Who Obeyed Allah are two sides to one coin, and that coin is called Wahabism. Please don't think I am saying Wahhabis to insult. No, that is just the name. And I remember once hearing an English convert to Islam. I think it's Yusuf Estes. And he was given a whole wrong lecture. He doesn't speak Arabic, and suddenly he became a professor in Arabic. And he was telling people that it was not allowed to call them Wahhabism, because the Wahhab is the name of Allah. And this is absolutely nonsense. Wahhabi is an adjective. We are defining somebody. And we can do that with anything. Except even we say this is Rabbani, this is godly-like. It's permitted, there is no problem with that. But I think it was the try of Muhammad, or what's his name, Yusuf Estes, to actually defend Wahhabis, because that's where he studied and that's what he preaches. It's sad news, but in anyway, the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah looked at the world from a completely different angle. The only ones that obeyed Allah were them, and the rest of the world wasn't. As I said already, such understanding exists today, and Saudis see themselves as the ones who follow the path of the righteous predecessors, and as opposed to the rest of the world is not. Really sad thinking, really. Needless to say that the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah was an extremist as extreme as their teacher, Mohamed Ibn AbdulWahaab. After his death, people shunned away his extremist views, and life went back to how it was before he came. Then came those brothers of those who obeyed Allah, and they revived that old injury and back to square one again. Their contraventions are more than you can shake a stick at, and the bad effects of their teachings can still be seen and witnessed today in the medieval Saudi of today. For instance, these were some of their beliefs, and see how not much has changed. They opposed any form of technology. The King AbdulAziz nearly lost his newly founded state because they refused and issued haram fatwa for the following. Usage of telegraph. They say it is haram because it's demons-operated cable. They also prohibited the usage of bicycle. They say they are satanic means of transport. They also forbade the usage of spoons and forks. They criticized and said, you are defying Allah's creation, the fingers. So to them it was haram to eat with a spoon or a fork. They also refused the usage of cars because they said they are being pulled by horses and hidden by the jinn. If a man doesn't have a beard and only has a mustache, they shaved his mustache with a threat. If he doesn't grow a beard, they will punish him. Women were not allowed markets under any circumstances. Stalls holders and businesses were escorted to a small yard near a masjid. In that yard, they will find a group of guardians, and they will be women covered from head to toes. You see absolutely nothing of them. If a woman wants to buy from a business or a stallholder or something like that, she would find herself accompanied by one of the guardians. Conversation with the seller is kept to a strict minimum. Their argument was, one man and one woman with the shaitan equals zina and fornication. So they wanted to cut the path in the way of shaitan so that no fornication should ever happen. Ya Allah. Oh. La ilaha illallah. No wonder women in Saudi Arabia have no rights whatsoever. No wonder women in Saudi Arabia are not allowed to drive. The only people on earth that can't drive are Muslim women because of Islam. No wonder in the Muslim world or the world as a whole, no Saudi Arabia woman running her own business. You crazy? You mad? Women are not even allowed. So much so that when some women were allowed to work in the government, it was a huge celebration, and Saudis thought they have already won the golden medal in equality between men and women. Very, very sad times that women and still are going through today. But anyway, the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah also had something else that hasn't changed much. They were very keen and easy issuers of takfir tickets on anyone who was not following their extreme and very, very innovative, strict, and sick ideologies. They had narrow-minded, narrow understandings, and they wanted the world to understand Islam through their eyes. The list goes on and on and on and on, but this is just a taster. You remember when I said the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah were the main army of King AbdulAziz, and that with his help and his leadership and their leadership, they killed so many tribes to unify them under one banner. The flag of the Saudi state today is as good as that of the Brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah. Not much difference. I will also have it in the poster so you can see that not much has changed. Because they were the main players in the army of AbdulAziz, they killed mercilessly and they got used to. Their banner was, if someone was not believing as we do, he was not a Muslim, we kill. And once they kill, they take the women as slaves. And once they are as slaves, they are sold, they are used, they are abused, and kids also of other Muslims, they grow as servants and slaves. All this is because their leader, Mohamed ibn AbdulWahaab, had designed for them some kind of a shape of a tawheed, and he told them, as I read to you his English translation and the Arabic, that he didn't know the meaning of La ilaha illallah. He didn't know the true meaning of Islam until Allah bestowed upon him some goodness, understanding of Islam, and only to him. This is a psychopathic thinking. This is someone who really has some personal issues to think that way. But the alliance between the Brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah and the King AbdulAziz was not to last. And that is because the Brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah had the strongest, deepest, and most affirmed belief, just like their first leader, Muhammad ibn AbdulWahaab, that they were the only authentic, true, direct, clear, and cleanest representation of the lifestyle of a Salaf. In their eyes, just like in the eyes of Muhammad ibn AbdulWahaab, the only true Salafi Muslim were them, while the rest of the Muslim world were innovators, deviated, misguided, and polytheists. Not much has changed in that respect until today. At the beginning of the revolt came and their annihilation not far after that. The Brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah regarded the rest of the world as kuffar. It doesn't matter if the other people call adhan or they pray to go to hajj to them, they are kuffar. And as such, they used to attack the Muslims inhabitants of anywhere and pillage their towns, take their women as prisoners of war and treat them as slaves, selling them, sleeping with them, and they didn't care. Invasions became their favorite jihad for the sake of Allah, believe it or not. So one day, and after they finished their war against different tribes, they invaded the Hijaz. The Hijaz is Saudi Arabia to the west, where Jeddah is, Mecca and Al-Madina, that strip there. But Al-Hijaz was different than the desert. Al-Hijaz had high buildings, banks, it had a lot of civilization in it. And that was the first time that those who obeyed Allah, the Brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah, came in contact with other civilization. But again, another problem was facing them. The Brotherhood folks could not adjust to the new world. And this created a huge gap between them, with their archaic religious belief, and the newly advanced and modern political world. And conflicts rose and are still today rising until our times in these days. The Brotherhood never got used to technological world, and so are the scholars of the Wahhabis movement today. They still are living in the past. So when the leaders and people of the Brotherhoods of those who obeyed Allah saw Jeddah, saw Mecca, saw all these things, they were smitten. So the leaders were adamant and very insisting to attack Jeddah with force as they used to, wanting the riches of this pretty city. They just wanted to attack it because that's what they got used to. They looked for the tiniest excuse as to why these people, one person perhaps, did something wrong, and they will rule that the whole city is like that person, and as such it must be attacked. But King AbdulAziz opposed that decision, fearing that the English fleet, which was coasting nearby to protect the foreigners on people on that city or in that city, would attack them. A long story short, two leaders from the Brotherhood asked to be appointed governors over Mecca and Medina, which, by the way, were conquered by these two leaders. That's why they asked to be governors of this Mecca and Al-Madina, because it was their war spoils. But the king, King AbdulAziz, refused their requests and instead appointed his members of his Saudi family. The two leaders got angry and as a consequence to that, pulled back their forces and went back to Najd, Riyadh today. Few other immigrant leaders joined forces with them and they warned King AbdulAziz. Few incidents that took place between the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah and the other nations, Muslim nations, because remember they didn't or they weren't used to meeting foreign people. They used to kill people, they live with themselves and kill the others. So in the summer of 1925, it was the first Hajj season after the attack and conquest of Mecca by the Brotherhood. The city was full of Ikhwan, and that's what they call them, the Brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah, Ikhwan man ta'Allah, who came to perform Hajj. The Egyptians back in that time were the ones who used to clothe the Kaaba. So when they were coming to clothe the Kaaba, what the Egyptians did, they prepared a fanfare just like the army march. And they wanted to celebrate that before they get to the Kaaba and dress it. But the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah saw that as evil. And they thought music was haram and that the Egyptians were filthying the holy city. So what they did is they started shooting at the crowd, killing so many Egyptians and other people. And that created a political conflict between Egypt and the King of Saudi Arabia. A conflict that didn't go well, and that was not the last conflict that this kind of people would cause until today. Another conflict rose as well. It's called the tobacco conflict. The brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah considered smoking as haram. And not only that, they considered anyone who smokes as a kafir. With such a harsh ruling, King AbdulAziz ordered the burning and destruction of all tobacco present in Jeddah. It was about 100,000 of British pounds tobacco at that time there. So the merchants and business people went to King AbdulAziz and explained to him that by burning tobacco, he was losing and depriving himself of added taxes, which is the VAT, and import taxes that he could take advantage of. So when he saw the gain in selling tobacco, he gathered a group of scholars, and especially that the British Empire had stopped their financial aid to the king since 1924. So when he gathered his scholars and told them about what was going on with the tobacco, they issued a fatwa making people or telling people that smoking was only disliked, it was not haram, and that it was not a major sin, i.e. people could smoke, and that is how the tobacco was accepted in Saudi Arabia. Of course, that created again another conflict with the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah, and until today in Saudi Arabia, smoking is haram, and they couldn't just say kafir, but they used every terminology that leads down the route of qualifying somebody as kafir. Also, notice how King AbdulAziz gathered his scholars who turned a ruling from haram and the smoker is a kafir to a disliked and the smoker is not committing a major sin. Can you see here how they play with Islam to their own advantage? Anyhow, as I already mentioned, the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah considered that the telephone, the telegraph, cars, bikes, or watches are all acts of magic and sihr. And for that, they qualify them as haram. I.e. you wear a watch in your wrist, that is haram. They were so thick that they prevented King AbdulAziz from taking advantage of the telegraph during his wars. In 1926, the king was forced to stop using the telegraph because the stubbornful and thick brotherhoods kept cutting the telegraph cables off and considering that an act of worship because it was an evil and it was an act of worship to remove that evil. And every time they cut a cable, they get a good deed for it. How thick that is, how thick. And that thickness is still present today in those so-called the High Council of Scholars. It's pure thickness, believe me. If you understood Arabic, you'll know what I mean. In 1926, things got really nasty. The leaders of the Brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah held a general meeting in Al-Artawiyah. They went back, remember, to Al-Artawiyah, where they gathered. And they pledged to support and defend the religion of Allah and die for the sake of Allah and for Islam. They openly defined the king, AbdulAziz, and in his face they protested the following. His friendship, mutual help, and reliance on the British and signing on accords and treaties with them, knowing that the Islamic law prohibits this kind of dealings. So they missed all the trades and business doings with other nations. Number two, appointing himself king when Islam prohibits and makes it haram to have a kingdom. Now, do you think that that has worked? Of course, Saudi Arabia is a kingdom. Number three, they objected the sending of his son, the prince Saud, to Egypt, and that because they used to believe that Egypt was not a Muslim land. La ilaha illallah. Number four, they also objected the sending of his son, the prince Faisal, to London. Number five, they objected the usage of cars, phones, and telegraphs. Number six, they objected the usage of the imposed taxes on the Hijaz and Najd, and Islam prohibits taxes. Number six, they objected his authorization to tribes from Iraq and Jordan to allow their animals to graze on Muslim lands. They are really sickos, subhanAllah, because still they consider Iraq and Jordan and any other thing not Muslims. That's why they say, how can you allow Iraqis and Jordanians to graze their animals on Muslim lands, because they didn't consider these people as Muslims. Number seven, they also objected the business prohibitions with the people of Kuwait, who are also Muslims. They wanted him to either consider them, i.e. the people of Kuwait, as kuffar, and in which case they will kill them and attack them, or not cause them as kuffar, and why still prohibiting business with them. Number eight, why is he silent towards the Shia of Al-Ahsa and Qatif? These are people that live still today in Saudi Arabia. They're completely alienated, abandoned. Oh, you wouldn't believe these people are considered not Muslims at all. But in any way, they said, why is he silent towards the Shia in Saudi Arabia and not force them to enter in the religion of the Sunnis? And still there is no compulsion in Islam, but they still insist on that. The number nine is they objected his refusal to destroy the tombs of the companions in Mecca and Al-Madinah. These are scary demands. So the Sheikh, or the king of Saudi Arabia, what he did, he countered that conventions of theirs with another one in Al-Riyadh, the city of Al-Riyadh, on January of 1927. So when King AbdulAziz heard that the leaders of the Brotherhood of Those Who Obeyed Allah movement had held a convention against him, he speedily went back to Riyadh and called for a national convention in which he invited tribes, leaders, scholars, and a member from the Brotherhood. Few points were addressed, and I want to keep this short, so I will only mention those points which led to the war against the Brotherhood, and as a result of that, their annihilation, physical annihilation, because the way they think still is dominating and domineering in Saudi Arabia today. Of the 4 points that they agreed upon and which will help us close on history is point number one. They ask for the removal of the man-made laws in Al-Hijaz, that is in Jeddah. What are the British? What they meant is, we don't want to walk or do whatever the British tell us. We want the Islamic laws. And he said, okay, we remove those man-made laws and we will apply the Islamic laws. It is nonsense to say that that didn't work, and later on, the King AbdulAziz, after he killed them all, went back to these old laws and things went better. Number two, after intensive give and take and conviction and everything, he came to a conclusion, I mean the King AbdulAziz, that the prohibition of telegraph can't be decided until further studies are made. They accepted this point here, but they still were not convinced that it was permitted to use telegraph. Number three, they came to the agreement that the Shia will be forced to swear allegiance that they will follow Islam while prohibiting them from externalizing their rituals. This is like very oppressive, subhanAllah. Number four, the jihad topic and the decision to have it or not is left to the imam, i.e. the king, and he decides what's best for Muslims and what's not. It is the last point about jihad that didn't go well at all with the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah, and they openly challenged King AbdulAziz, saying, how come jihad was wanted and announced when it served your purpose, when we fought with you against tribes and we killed other people so that you can rule big and wide? Why was jihad back then allowed, and now that when it is against the British people, you make it not allowed? And the reasons were because the King AbdulAziz, the King of Saudi Arabia, had agreed with the British on certain things about the petrol, about so many things, and he couldn't fight them because it was part of the treaty with them. But that didn't sit well with the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah, and they retaliated, and that declared the war on King AbdulAziz, who sought the help of the British Empire to help him against these people. And the British brought in guns and military and everything, and they helped King AbdulAziz annihilate the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah and remove them from geography. But the only problem with that was that their physicality, the bodies were dead and some of them scattered, but their belief and the way of looking at things and their thinking is still present in modern medieval Saudi Arabia. They are still thick, and believe me, there are books written by scholars in Saudi Arabia, the title of which, Haqiqat Kuratul Qadam, the truth about football play. And they linked it to so many things, people now are making laughing stock of them, because now there is a Saudi cup about playing football. And that book made it haram, just like his predecessors, just like phone is haram, just like using, oh, Lordy Lord, where can I go and where can I stop? 1929, 1930, and the whole problem with the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah was done with, and Saudi Arabia belonged to the king, and he started building his armies and things like that. This is the reason why Saudi Arabia is today the way it is, because they do not want, the government knows that under every beard there, everyone who calls himself a sheikh is a brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah. This is why the Saudis see themselves as the only ones who are the Salafi, and all of us are in hellfire. It's a sick way of thinking, and believe me, they think like they are the only ones who are going to go to paradise. And this is absolutely nonsense. Alhamdulillah, so many scholars now in Saudi Arabia have started telling, look, that is not true. Islam is not what the brotherhood or Mohamed Ibn AbdulWahaab had brought to us. One day I will discuss the evidences of Mohamed Ibn AbdulWahaab, and believe me, scholars have discussed them, and they have showed what was wrong and what is wrong with them and why they are costing us a lot of things. Now, why am I telling you all the story? Because the Muslim brotherhood that was in Egypt, or the Ikhwan al-Muslimin that are today with us today, was created towards the end of the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah. So as the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah was given a hard time and darkening the world in Saudi Arabia, another Muslim brotherhood was created and invented or founded in Egypt by a man called Hassan al-Banna. When he was looking for a name of the Muslim brotherhood, he took the brotherhood from the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah as a sign of barakah, because they thought that these people, because they reclaimed back Mecca and Al-Madinah, who were under the British, they reclaimed them back. People were looking high up to these people of the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah. So when he looked for a name to his party, he thought like, okay, let me call my one brotherhood, but instead of having who obeyed Allah, he called of Muslims, Muslim Brotherhood. And that was how the name was born. Before 1928, when the Muslim Brotherhood was founded in Egypt, there was never anybody out there that thought of politicizing Islam. And that is to make a party and make it Muslim. Before that, it was Islam, and that was that. The founder, Hassan al-Banna, alayhi rahmatullah, got this idea from Jamaluddin al-Afghani, a man, a great man that came before him. And sadly so, the brotherhood of those who claim obey Allah have qualified Jamaluddin al-Afghani as a vile Shia, as it is always the case with these people. Anybody who calls for advance is vile, is Shia, is murtad, is everything. But in any way, Hassan al-Banna got this idea from Western parties, such as the fascists, the Nazis, the liberals, the Democrats, and ask the obvious question, why isn't there a Muslim party, or why isn't there an Islamic party? And the Muslim Brotherhood of Egypt was created to fill that gap, to create a Muslim or an Islamic party. The concept of the Muslim Brotherhood of Egypt was crafted by different ideologies. A bit of harmless retreat like Sufism, along with a Salafi penchant, especially that Hassan's father, Hassan al-Banna, who is the founder of the Muslim Brotherhood, was a sheikh in the Salafi movement, and he was a scholar in hadith. And it was the father who compiled the hadith of an Imam Ahmed, Musnad al-Imam Ahmed, known as Al-Fath al-Rabbani, the divine gift. And he did it in very well way, and he kept teaching it. He was well known in the Salafi groups and also in Ahlul Hadith, the people al Hadith. Hassan al-Banna was a great strategist, but not an ideas maker. And as such, his movement formed it, and it worked hard, very hard, on how to bring together the world of politics and the world of religion to serve the purpose of using Islamic ideologies to fight non-Islamic ideologies. At its core, it was a good idea. As the movement developed and grew, people started noticing a play, a deliberate play, and the party positions on some issues, its relationship with others, and also the clarity and contradictions that the group or the party showed. And this created a bit of confusion in people where this group was going. And this is why people today, they say Al-Ikhwan or the Muslim Brotherhood, they are this and they are that, is because they take different stance. They morph quickly with the situations, just like politicians do. To gain platform in its infancy, the Brotherhood or the Muslim Brotherhood had contacted with so many different Western political parties to gain credibility. And they connected with Germany. They even got sponsored and financed by the British government and received funds to support their growth. It was King AbdulAziz who helped the movement of Muslim Brotherhood stand on their feet with support and donations. King AbdulAziz found a way to buy men of religion's allegiance by financially supporting them, and this act drove many scholars to overlook and even hide the fact that King AbdulAziz rebelled and broke a peace from the lands of the Khilafah. And this strategy is still followed by Saudi Arabia until our time now. They buy scholars, they sponsor them, they do a lot of things. And once you see the sprinkling, shining coin in your hand, you forget a lot of things and justifications start happening. Hassan al-Banna spent time in Saudi Arabia as well, learning from the Salafi teachings. He attended classes by Rashid Rida Ali Rahmatullah, great Salafi, and also Muhibbuddin al-Khatib. The group was officially launched in 1928, and their first official political intervention was in 1934, when the king of Saudi Arabia was attacked by a man from Yemen, and the Muslim Brotherhood sent him an official condemnation about the act, and that was their first political approach to matters of politics. The Muslim Brotherhood kept growing, but the biggest growth, or the drastic growth, happened when a man called Sayyid Qutb came to join the group. And he wrote a book called Under the Shades of Al-Qur'an, and which he explains the Qur'an and comments on it, and in that he made some very dangerous statements, and not very far from the belief of Mohamed Ibn AbdulWahaab, not very far from the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah, where he saw the majority of the Muslim world as kuffar. Today, the extremist group like Daesh, ISIS, Qaeda, and anyone, or the jihadi movement in Egypt or anywhere, those people who kill people, they take his teachings as the Quran. So to them, they have three people that they take from: Ibn Taymiyyah, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, and Sayyid Qutb. These are the pivots of those hate and blood-shedding references. So why suddenly the Muslim Brotherhood turned evil. What made the scholars of Saudi Arabia label this great Muslim Brotherhood as evil? Why have they kept quiet for the last 89 years? Nobody ever issued any fatwa against these people until this president of Egypt overthrew the president Mohamed Morsi, who was of the Muslim Brotherhood. Then after that, they labeled him as terrorist, and they declared in Egypt that the Muslim Brotherhood is a terrorist organization. And this is absolutely evil, oppression, transgression, and just pure evil. I have lived in Egypt for almost 6 years, and I have seen what the Muslim Brotherhood does to help poor people. And I can tell you stories. And remember, I am not one of them, and I am not a sympathizer or nothing. They are just my Muslim brothers. But they are doing great jobs in Egypt and worldwide. So now that Egypt wants them to be qualified and classified throughout the world as a terrorist group, even America said classifying all the Muslim Brotherhood as terrorists is not possible, and it will cause a lot of problems throughout the world, because they are in Kuwait, they are in Jordan. Hamas in Palestine is also of Muslim Brotherhood. So where is the problem? What happened to Qatar? How can we link the whole thing? Look at it this way. The world today wants Israel to have a state. Donald Trump's speech have made it clear that he wants to bring total peace into Israel and give Israel the best deals ever. He said it in his presidential campaign. He said it later on. And it really is not surprising that the first trip he makes should be to the Middle East so that he can levels up, so that he can give Israel what he promised that country. But there is one problem. Palestine is not empty. A portion of it is the treacherous Fatah and its president Abbas, who are willing to sell anything to anyone so that he stays a president and they get some piece of the cake. Now, but on the other party, there is Hamas, and Hamas is actively fighting and does not want to sell, right? Hamas has been a Muslim Brotherhood party for the last 30 years, if not more. For a long time, the West and Middle East with Egypt want to put an end to the conflict with Israel, but not at the expense of Israel, but rather at the expense of Hamas. So how do we do that? Qatar supports Hamas with the news coverage, humanitarian financial aids, and it helps them because Qatar believes in the fight and struggle of the Palestinians. But Saudi Arabia has already sold. United Arab Emirates has already sold. Bahrain has already sold to Jerusalem, to Israel. Egypt has already sold, and for decades. But Qatar hasn't. So how can we attack Hamas and force it to sell to the Jews by cutting any outside assistance? The Saudis sold a long time ago, as I said, and the wife of the perished king of Saudi Arabia, King Fahd, Mrs. Jinan Harb, who was a Palestinian Christian secret wife to King Fahd, and who recently won a case against the royal family in which she won £20 million. But Israel, when she was asked if the Jews were in Saudi Arabia today, she said, "Israelis travel free and as they please. They have always done, and Fahd died in 2005. The Jews go to Saudi Arabia for businesses, and they enter and they go, and you don't even know of them, and the government of Saudi Arabia knows that. Yet Fahd was a drunkard and a drug user, and that's why they entitled him, they gave him the high title of the servant of the second of the two holy shrines, to give him a different picture, and people fell in that, and they never noticed his drinking wine and taking drugs. This is sad, sad, sad. But anyway, what's going on now against Qatar is nothing else but to force Qatar, who is a sympathizer with Hamas, to cut down in news coverage and also financial thing. And that's why the Saudis brought the lie and the fabrication with the United Arab Emirates and Bahrain and Egypt, who are allied to Israel anyway. Even Benjamin Netanyahu, in an interview, he said that they are already making and having business deals with Saudi Arabia. And do you know what? pretty soon, probably in the next year, if not less, Saudi Arabia is going to open its skies for Jerusalem and Jewish planes to fly across Saudi Arabia as a first step to see how the world of Saudis will react, and gradually, until you will see the Jewish people with their Hasidic dresses walking down in Al-Madina. It's not very far from that. So the problem is not the Muslim Brotherhood, but the problem is those who are still believing in the Muslim Brotherhood and are using that. So by looking to making the Muslim Brotherhood as a worldwide terrorist organizations, Qatar will be labeled as a terrorist organization, and so Hamas. And subhanAllah, how times have changed and how our leaders are selling cheap. Now, why would those Wahhabi sheikhs say that a brotherhood or the Muslim brotherhood are not giving any interest about the aqidah or the sunnah? First of all, the term aqidah is an innovative term. Allah calls it belief, al-iman, in al-Quran. But I'm going to go with their innovative terms. Because to them, what they mean is they have, the Muslim Brotherhood must teach and preach what the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah and what Mohamed ibn AbdulWahaab believed in. That's what they mean by the aqidah and the sunnah. And guess what? Not everybody shares what the Saudis, the Wahhabis, believe. It's exactly like that of Mohammed ibn AbdulWahaab, of the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah. It's my way or the sword's way. There is no other way. And absolutely not true. And also when these high scholars say that they are not the people with authentic curriculums, who gives the authority to these people of Saudi Arabia to judge who is on the right curriculum or not? The Saudis themselves are on wrong curriculums. They have written a book, and I have the book, and it makes you cringe, and it's printed in Saudi Arabia, and that what they say in Saudi Arabia must believe in. They say that Allah is actually seated on his arsh, seated as like you and me. And they say Allah has got a beginning and end, i.e. he's got a shape like you've got a side. You begin from one end and you end on the other end. And if you don't believe in that, you are a disbeliever. I tell them, go take a hike from here into Jerusalem and back and go to Washington and do whatever you want to do. Not every of your belief is what everybody should believe in. So you see, when they say that these people do not follow the authentic curriculum, what they mean is our curriculum, Muhammad ibn AbdulWahaab, the Wahhabi's curriculum. When they say they do not pay attention to calling to the correct of aqidah, correction of aqidah, again, correction of belief to what the Wahhabis believe, no, thank you very much. Certain things are correct, certain things are not correct. But please don't patronize us. Again, the Wahhabis, they think they are the true religion. And that's why I told you about Mohammed AbdulWahaab, who killed murderers. He's a war criminal on what he killed. And then those who came after him, the brotherhood of those who obeyed Allah. Look at that term. It's so despiteful. It's so full of themselves. Like they obeyed Allah and everybody else didn't obey Allah. And Allah says in the Quran, وَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, do not overpraise yourselves. And also they say they are political parties seeking to reach ruling. Subhanallah. You know what? This is the creeps of the Wahhabis and the Salafis. They go to hiding true facts of history just because they want you to remain the pair of shoes of a ruler. Abdullah ibn Zubayr, after the death and the murdering of Ali radiallahu anhu, he became the ruler, Khalifa, for 10 years over Mecca and so many other places. And people gave him allegiance. And he was a legitimate governor before Banu Umayyah did their acts. For 10 years. And the Wahhabis hide it. Do you know why? Because Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu was a man of the sword. He used to fight for his right. All the Sahaba that supported Ali have been marginalized. Ali ibn Abi Talib, the boy who embraced Islam when he was 6, who lived with Rasulullah ﷺ in Mecca and in Al-Madinah, who knows the life of Rasulullah ﷺ in and out. Do you know how many ahadith do we have that are narrated by Ali? 50 of them scattered in the books of ahadith, no more than 22 or 23 in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. Come on. Come on, ya Bani Umayyah. Come on, ya Wahhabis. What are you hiding from the world? Ali radiallahu anhu, who embraced Islam when he was 6, knows the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Mecca, who slept in the place of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and married his daughter sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and is the father of the grandchildren of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We only have 50 ahadith about him and all the insults. That tells you how much the impact and influence of politics and the government on Islam that we have today. Why would they say Hizbiyun, they are a party seeking to reach ruling? Where is the problem by seeking ruling? What's the problem? Where is the problem in seeking ruling? Are we women in Ahl Sunnah? Are we just like this? We just take, we never give? What's wrong with the world? And what's wrong with being a ruler? Ronald Reagan was an actor. He ended up being the president of the United States. Arnold Schwarzenegger, he was just an athlete and an actor, and he became governor of California. Barack Obama, a black man with some ambition, became the president of the United States. A businessman, Donald Trump, became the president of the United States. Why is it okay for other people to become rulers? Why do you endeavor and work so hard at securing and protecting the throne of the Saudis? What's wrong with us Muslims become leaders and be good leaders of the world? Wallahi al-azim, la ilaha illallah. We leave this to Allah on the Day of Judgment. We will see you. How you want to feminize us, but we will refuse to be ladies. And one day, a Muslim leader will rule Saudi Arabia and will show the world the beauty of how Muslims can be when they have the right leader. And I pray to Allah to bring that forward. Oh, the Wahhabis, they get me on my nerves. And also they say their curriculum and system relies on going against and opposing the government. Of course. Yeah, subhanallah. I'm thinking like I'm talking to idiots who have never read the Al-Quran. This is the High Council of Scholars in Saudi Arabia. I wonder, maybe they just used the names and there was some idiot in an office who typed this. Allah knows what goes on in there. My dear brothers and my sisters, the Muslim Brotherhood are not vile. Qatar is not vile. Saudi Arabia is vile. United Arab Emirates is vile. Al-Bahrain is vile. Egypt is corrupted and vile more than vile. These are the snakes that need to put an end to. We have got to tell these people to stop, and only Allah knows how, since we Muslims are too busy with our differences and our problems. Again, I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the idea now is clear and that you shouldn't follow the news just because of what it is. Qatar is a good country that's doing great. Saudi Arabia is the evil. And I swear to Allah, if Saudi Arabia didn't have Mecca and Medina and a little bit of petrol, they will be begging on the doors of masajid, of mosques. Wallahi al-azim, they'll be begging and nobody would look at them. And every time they talk, someone's going to smack them on the head. It is just that they happen to be at the place of the two most holy places for us on earth, and Allah gave them wealth because of the da'wah of our father Ibrahim. What can we say? We gotta be patient until Allah sends us someone who will kick the else out from where they are and place someone who is good to the Muslim and to the world as a whole. This is again your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa, and I have kept this talk to a minimum because there is far more to say than ever, but this should give you an idea about all the bloodshed that's been spilled in the name of Islam. Allah Kareem, and I pray to Allah to forgive all those who died. Ameen. Wa salli Allahumma ala nabiyyina Muhammad. To join my group, just send me a message on WhatsApp on 0044-78-76-40-8735. And I wish you well. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika. Nashhadu la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.